Hi, and welcome to the Future of Dermatology podcast. I'm your host, Dr. Faranak Kamangar, board-certified dermatologist. We are here to talk about anything and everything dermatology-related. You'll hear from me and my guests, who are dermatologists, physicians, experts, scientists, residents, and medical students in the field of dermatology. We publish weekly, so if you like what you hear, hit that subscribe button and show us some love, and thank you for joining us.
I am so excited for today's episode. We have as our guest none other than James Kilgour, who is a prior SF Derm med student back in the day. I'm so excited to have James on. He is now a dermatology resident finishing at Stanford, and he's going to be a dermatologist extraordinaire. He's done so many great things, and it's been so fun to watch his career develop. But the latest thing is, I feel like, James, I'm seeing you everywhere for KilgourMD, and I'm so excited about this this line you have to treat hair and the scalp, and it's just so unique. But thank you so much for joining us.
Yeah, thank you, Farah. I was so excited to be on the podcast with you.
Yeah, this is fantastic. Do you remember, James, it was like years ago, I think it was in the beginning of maybe COVID, where we were doing our virtual conferences, and like me and James were just like tucked away in an office at my work doing one of our like bigger virtual conferences, and everybody was figuring out how to deal with medical education during COVID and all of that.
Yeah, I remember very fondly. We had all of the ring lights.
We had so many ring lights. I think I left the room. We're like, I can't, my eyes can't focus. But we've had so much fun together. And let us know a little bit about actually your background. Your education is so interesting. If you want to just even to give a few seconds of your medical journey.
Yeah, sure. Well, I'm originally from the UK, you know, grew up in a small town outside of Oxford. I went to medical school in Wales and then was doing residency at Oxford and, you know, had my whole life mapped out, was going to live and die in Oxford. And I ended up meeting my now husband, who's American, and just, you know, falling in love. It was as close to love at first sight as I think is possible. And ended up moving to California. And I gave my parents maybe 2 months notice that I was moving. They weren't super excited at the time about that. And ended up at Stanford. I did a postdoc with a wonderful mentor, Dr. Kavita Sarin, developing a novel skin cancer therapeutic and some other great translational work. Ended up staying for my residency training, and which is now kind of coming towards its end, which is exciting.
Yeah, it's so exciting. And I can't wait to see all the amazing things you'll do once you hit clinical practice. But tell us about KilgourMD. And I just have to set the stage here. I first saw the formulation. I was like, oh my gosh, this is fantastic. But tell us, like, how did this get started? What you're doing with this? It's so unique, the formulation you've come up with. At what point in your research and in all your work did you start kind of putting this together in your head?
Yeah, there's two things. One, I always wanted to be an entrepreneur. I grew up watching Dragon's Den, which is the British version of Shark Tank. So always wanted to kind of do something in business, but never really had the confidence. And I think when I moved to the other side of the world, it really gave me that sense of, if I can do that, then I can do anything. And I actually went to a talk with, a skincare brand during residency, and the founder had been dissatisfied with her career in a completely different field, you know, not related to medicine or skincare. And she just liked skincare. And so she decided to start a skincare brand. And it made me think, well, if she can do it, like, I can do it, you know, and I think skincare products, sometimes as dermatologists, we kind of sometimes don't realize how important they are, not just as a cosmetic, but actually just for fundamental skin health. And, you know, we prescribe a lot of medications as dermatologists, but I feel like the one thing that our patients use religiously are their skincare products, you know, from Sephora. They put their own money into it. And there's actually a lot of science that goes into these products. So that was one thing. And then the other thing is, just during residency, you know, I see so many patients with hair loss, so many women particularly, and really was able to see kind of how profoundly devastating it was for people. And the most common type is kind of that age-related kind of androgenetic alopecia that we see. And obviously the conventional wisdom is that it's genetic and it's male hormone driven. But from our wonderful mentors at Stanford and from the research community, really began to understand this role of kind of the environment and the way that the environment ages our scalp. And it's funny because in clinic, so many times I would tell patients, you know, you have this inherited form of hair loss, and they would look at me in disbelief and they would say, how could I have inherited this? My parents had a full head of hair. And it's a good question. And I didn't have a good answer for them. And it was really that understanding of the environment and the way that the environment is aging the scalp that really kind of was that light bulb moment to really think, well, why don't we have a skincare regimen for the scalp and really treat the scalp like we treat the face? And so that really is what led to this idea of KilgourMD and really a skincare system for the scalp.
No, I love it. And you bring up such a good point, because we say a lot of our patients, whenever we give them any diagnosis, they're like, why did this happen to me? And a lot of times we say genetics, but there is this whole epigenetic factor, because not everybody in that lineage has gotten the thing, you know? So they're like, well, why didn't everyone else in my family get this condition? And why did I? And that's because of environment, stress, all these other things. We don't have a lot of time, a 10-minute visit to go over all of that. So it's actually a really unmet need. I don't know why this isn't looked at more. And then we usually will say, well, let's do minoxidil or let's do these oral medications. And you do feel like patients are a little bit dissatisfied almost with just those answers. And like I just love that you've kind of created this entire way of thinking about it. Like, why not do skincare for your scalp the way we do for the rest of your skin?
Yeah, absolutely. And you know, one of our wonderful mentors at Stanford shared with us this really great research study where they basically took young hair follicles and implanted them into aged skin in the lab, and they stopped growing. And then they did the opposite. They took aged hair follicles and implanted them into young skin, and actually the hair follicles switched back on. And that's because really that microenvironment around the hair follicle is just as important as the hair follicle itself, if not more important. And so that's really why treating the scalp as a fully fledged member of the kind of skin family is so fundamental.
That's such a good point. That experiment is amazing. And that's probably why we see so many patients with like hair transplant, for example, right? They're doing exactly that. They have an area of hair loss, and then they're taking follicles from a different area and putting it there. And that hair can fall out over time too, because you really haven't addressed the main issue, which is the environment and the aging environment around it.
Yeah, absolutely. That's kind of the core idea. And, you know, it's funny, I talk to investors a lot, you know, and so many times they say, you know, why has anyone else thought of this? And, you know, it's a great question. And I think sometimes the most simple ideas can be the ones that are the most elusive. And, you know, I don't know why no one else really thought of this concept, but I you know, I think it's so fundamental.
It's so true. And I can, you know, like direct your investors to me, because nobody really has. It's true, you know, because I'm sure investors are in different fields and might not know dermatology. And like, well, no, but this must be something everyone else is doing. No, not really. First time we say do minoxidil, then maybe we add some oral medications like finasteride or dutasteride, spironolactone, oral contraceptives. I don't think at any point we're saying let's improve the texture of your scalp. I guess maybe the one caveat is we do a lot of PRP in my practice. So we're kind of maybe doing that, you know, but then that is an injectable, that's an in-office procedure. And like you mentioned, people like doing things at home, and they should be doing, they shouldn't just be seeing me every 6 months and just doing the PRP. Between those 6 months, they should be doing scalp care.
Now for a quick word from our sponsors. DermPub is the Journal of Innovative Dermatology. We are committed to promoting excellence in dermatologic care through the dissemination of cutting-edge knowledge and fostering collaboration among dermatologists, researchers, and industry professionals. We believe that by sharing innovative ideas and discoveries, we can collectively drive progress and improve patient outcomes. Contact thefutureofdermatology@gmail.com to learn more about DermPub. Want to be a sponsor of the Future of Dermatology podcast? We'd love to have your support. Contact thefutureofdermatology@gmail.com to learn more about getting your message in front of our audience. The Future of Dermatology is not just a podcast. It is a community of dermatologists who care deeply about your health. DermGPT is the only advanced AI-powered tool specializing in dermatology. DermGPT allows dermatologists to ask questions in natural language and receive relevant, helpful answers, just like they would with real-life colleagues. Find DermGPT at www.dermgpt.com.
Have you ever wanted to produce your own podcast? OMG Media Outlet has all the tools and talents necessary to produce and promote your very own podcast, from recording to editing to publishing to promoting. They enable you and your podcast to shine while they do all the work. Contact Steph at omgmediaoutlet.com today to learn more.
And actually, we've partnered with PRP practices. So we actually sell our products into practices to sell as an at-home product for their patients. And so they really use it with the PRP. But PRP is such a great example because that really, again, is about the microenvironment. And that's why we're injecting the growth factors into the microenvironment. So it really, again, validates the central concept that it is the scalp that is so important.
I love it. Do you have any regimens where you start your topical before? Like, that would make sense. Like, start before, get the environment ready, then start injecting into the area.
Well, our two products that we launched with are really, which is really our system. One is our prevention product and one is more of our treatment product. And really the prevention, it's not a sunscreen, but it's kind of like a sunscreen in that it's about protecting and kind of maintaining scalp health over time. And how it does that is it does contain some agents to combat dandruff, which is actually really inflammatory. And kind of we talk about this inflammation pathway in the scalp. And so that's one way in which the product really is preventative. And it combines that with L-ascorbic acid, really that gold standard topical antioxidant for the skin. But to really allow it to penetrate, we liposomally encapsulated it. So it's within a liposome because ascorbic acid is normally water soluble. And so the liposome allows it to penetrate into those oil-rich areas of the scalp. And so that's really what I love to start patients with, is really that preventative approach. And then the treatment product really is for once that kind of pathogen has started to set in. And I love minoxidil, but, you know, many of our patients, as I'm sure Farah, you've experienced too, either don't want to use minoxidil or they've had kind of side effects from minoxidil. And so often are looking for kind of a different way of treating the issue.
Yeah, absolutely. I do see it sometimes in my patients when I bring it up and they're like, oh, just minoxidil again. You know, like they're looking for an alternative or maybe just an additive as well. Maybe it's working, but not enough. So it's wonderful to have kind of different options. And I love the concept of just, I think a lot more regenerative medicine is being focused on now, which is maybe around the time that you know, the investors asked, why haven't we thought about this before? I think things are changing a bit, whereas we're really looking at regenerative medicine, inflammaging, we're looking at things differently. We even see it with conditions like eczema, prurigo nodularis, the targets are changing. As well, and we had Dr. Mermarani on recently talking about frontal fibrosing alopecia, and she talked so much about, I mean, we still don't know the full story, but like chemical sunscreens, for example, could be a trigger, like an environmental trigger. So there's so much for understanding about the hair follicle and inflammaging that I think, you know, like the products like this not only help patients, but they help us understand the condition better too. So it's amazing that you're sitting there thinking about these things so thoroughly.
And I think kind of last thing I wanted to say is I feel like we're very lucky as dermatologists, I think in the Bay Area and in Northern California, I think our patients are really kind of ahead of the eight ball on really wanting to understand the root cause of disease and really the root cause of why something is happening. And I think as physicians, that pushes us to really kind of think and innovate around that idea, not just treating things reactively, but really thinking, okay, why is this happening? And I've certainly been very fortunate to train at Stanford, where we have such great scientists as well as clinicians that have really inspired me.
I agree with you. I think like just being here in Silicon Valley, being around Stanford, UCSF, all the different like entities, you can't help but be pushed to innovate and think about problems in a different way. So I really do love our community for sponsoring that thought. But I think this is just the beginning of it. I mean, I think what you've started is so interesting in changing the paradigm of how we think about scalp health. And this is, we always ask as a last question, it's the Future of Dermatology podcast. So we always ask, what are you excited about for the future?
Yeah, I'm really excited, I think, specifically in hair loss. I think we talked about it already, PRP. I think there is such a long way to go in really understanding what are the growth factors within PRP that are really helpful for hair growth, and really how can we control that mixture, that cocktail of growth factors within the plasma that we're injecting. I think PRP is super exciting. I think it really could get us to the point of really a precise way of treating this issue. And so I'm really excited about that.
Yeah, well, I'm really excited about you coming up with more answers for us too, because it's true. I love PRP. It really works. I think initially when I started doing it years ago, I was almost like, is this going to do anything? And then you see patients come back and are like, oh, wow, it did. And their scalp quality looks better too, which is really the your line of work of what you're doing, because we do have patients with like actinic damage, like visible signs of that inflammation, and that starts to improve. So there's so much of this. I think you're just at the beginning of the science. It's so exciting. And it's just, you're just a fantastic person. So it's amazing just to see your success and all the things you're doing.
Yeah. Thank you, Farah. Thank you. It's so nice to talk with you and share the kind of the story with your listeners. And always happy to connect or answer questions with anyone that's interested too.
Absolutely. Thank you so much, James. And I'd love to have you back on as the story unfolds and you can tell us all the amazing things that are happening with the science around what you're doing. But thanks again.
Thank you for listening to the Future of Dermatology podcast. Remember to hit that subscribe button and share the podcast with your friends. The more you share and subscribe, the more we'll be able to grow and share our dermatology knowledge. If you have burning dermatology questions, feel free to leave them in the comment below and we would love to address them in a future episode. And please note that this podcast is not intended to substitute for medical advice from your doctor.